Good morning, students. Welcome to Computer Organization class. This is Veena A. Patil from Department of Computer Science, BLDA's CET Vijaipur.
So, in the previous video, we have seen memory location, addressing, and operations. We saw how memory addresses are given, and on the basis of memory address. The number of bits, we can identify the size of the memory. We also saw Big Endian and Little Endian assignment. In Big Endian, the assignment starts from MSP to LSP, whereas in Little Endian, it starts from LSP to MSP. So today, we are going to learn about instruction and instruction sequencing. A computer performs a task according to the program stored in memory. A program is nothing but a collection of instructions, and instructions inform the processor to perform a basic operation like addition, reading from keyboard, etc. A computer should have instructions to perform at least four types of operations, which I have listed here. That is data transfer between the memory and processor register, arithmetic and logic operations on data, program sequencing and control, input-output transfers. A complete instruction set is referred to as instruction set architecture or ISA of the processor. In addition to specifying instruction, an ISA also specifies the addressing methods used for accessing data options and processor registers. Now we have here to illustrate this operations, different representation methods. So let's see the first one, which we call as register transfer notation or RTN. Register transfer notation, RTN, is also referred to as register transfer language or RTL. We identify a memory location by a symbolic name, usually in uppercase alphabets, like we have here LOC, NUM, R0, table, etc. We represent these locations by symbolic names. The contents of a location is denoted by placing square bracket around the name, as shown here. The right hand side of an RTN expression always denotes a value, and the left hand side is the symbolic name where the value is to be stored. All RTN statements will have an arrow symbol, whose left side is the destination and the right side is the source. Source contents are not modified, whereas destination contents are changed after an operation. Now, for example, let's consider RTN statement R1 with arrow I have shown here into square bracket LOC. This operation, it transfers the content of memory location LOC into processor register R1. The content of LOC is not changed, but the previous content of R1 is lost. That is, new value is overwritten on it. Now, if we take another example here, wherein I have shown R3 arrow into square bracket R1 plus in square bracket R2. This will add the content of the two registers R1 and R2 and place some into R3 of the processor. And such type of representation we call it as register transfer notation. So this is nothing but it is equivalent to saying R3 is equal to R1 plus R2, and this means R1 is equal to LOC. To mean content of, we write the square brackets. The RTN notation is easy to understand and generic way of illustrating an operation, but cannot be used to represent machine instructions. Since the processor understands only the binary format, we need to use a notation which could be converted into machine language format effectively. For this, a new format called assembly language is used. Here we use English-like words called mnemonics to represent an operation uniquely. For example, let's see how instruction is written in assembly language. As I have shown here, it is move LOC, R1, which is nothing but it is equivalent to moving the content of memory location called LOC into R1, that is copying the content of LOC into processor register R1. And the instruction which we had written in RTN representation, that is R1 plus R2 to be saved in R3. I can write the same thing using assembly language as add R1, R2, R3. So assembly language is a symbolic language using mnemonics to represent machine instructions. So this is better than the binary machine language wherein we use zeros and ones. Since user can write the programs using mnemonics, we prefer assembly language. A major limitation of assembly language is that it is not portable. That is, instruction written for one processor cannot be used with another processor. So, assembly language is machine dependent. To provide better and more flexible programming environment, high level languages like C, C++, Java are developed that are machine independent.
Let's have a look on basic instructions type. A statement like C is equal to A plus B, okay, C is equal to A plus B, in a high level language program informs the computer to add the value of the two variables called A and B and assign the sum to third variable called C. When the program is compiled, each variable is assigned a distinct address in memory. The content of these locations represent the value of three variables. Therefore, the operation required is nothing but content of A plus content of B. It has to be added and it has to be stored in C. So, this indicates that the content of memory location A and B are fetched from memory, transferred to the processor, sum is computed, and then result is stored in memory location C. To carry out this kind of operation, assembly language provides three types of instruction formats. The first one is three address instruction, which in which we are going to write the instruction in this format, wherein if I want to perform C is equal to A plus B, here add becomes the operation. It becomes the operation. Then this is source 1, source 2, and this is destination. Okay, using this format, the above operation, that is C is equal to A plus B, can be completed using a single machine instruction, that is add A comma B comma C, where A and B are called as source, C is the destination, as I already told, and add is the operation to be performed. This type has a disadvantage that instruction code would be too large to fit in one word location in memory. Next instruction type is two address instruction, in which two address instruction, the general format is
operation, source, common destination. I have written here add becomes operation. A is a source, B is a destination. Okay, this is simpler than previous format, but in this case a single instruction is not sufficient to carry out the above operation. Therefore two instructions are used to solve C is equal to A plus B problem. As you are seeing here, content of A is added with content of B and the answer is stored in B. Then I say move operation B comma C, that is the content of B is copied to C. Here move is actually a copy operation since it does not change the source operand. So coming to the third type, which is one address instruction, the general format is operation source or destination. The instruction specifies only memory operand which may be source or destination. The other operation is implied to be a processor register called accumulator. So the other operand is considered as a processor register called accumulator. All operations are to be performed on the contents of accumulator. Now for example, if I am performing add B, it means the content of memory location B will be added to the content of accumulator register and it will place the sum in the accumulator. Similarly, if I am performing load A, this will copy the content of memory location A into accumulator. So content of A will be copied into accumulator. And when I perform add B, content of B will be added with the content of accumulator and the result will be stored in the accumulator. Similarly, if I am saying store will transfer the content of accumulator to the memory location C. So it will copy the content of accumulator to memory location C. These are the three basic types. We have one more, that is zero address instruction. In this case, the location of all operands are defined implicitly. The operands are stored in a structure called pushdown stack. We shall see one more example on this. Now the example is evaluate A plus B into C plus D. Now using three address instruction, we can write it as first I am going to perform addition of A plus B and I am going to store it in R1. So how do I write the instruction? Add A comma B comma C. So these two will be added and it will be stored in R1. Okay. Then the second instruction, I am performing addition of C plus D and I want to store it in processor register R2. So C plus D will be added and it will be stored in R2 if I write add C comma D comma R2. Now once the answer of A plus B is in R1 and C plus D is in R2, I want to add these two and store it in a memory location called X. Multiply and store them. So I can write MUL which performs multiplication, R1 comma R2 comma X will perform content of R1 into content of R2 going to be stored in X. So this is using three address instruction. Same way I can also try it with two address instruction. In two address instruction, initially I am moving A in R1. So if we are going to write in this format M of A, it means if I write like this, it means that this is the name of, or this is the memory location. A is a memory location, whereas R1, R2, R3, these are processor registers. Okay, so value of A will be copied into processor register R1. Then we are performing add B to R1. We are adding the content of memory location B to the content of, it should be content of R1, and I am storing the result back to R1. Right? Then we are, same way we are trying to do with the next term, that is C+D. Here I am moving the content of C, that is memory location content, to R2, and then I am adding D to R2. So the content of D is added with the content of R2, and it is saved in R2. And lastly, we are going to say multiply R1 comma R2. So the content of R1 will be multiplied with the content of R2, and it will be stored in R2. After performing multiplication of R1 and R2, we are going to save the content of R2 into memory location X. The same way, you can also write the same instruction using one address format, wherein I am first taking the value of A and I am storing it into accumulator. Then to this accumulator I am going to add the content of B and storing the sum into the accumulator back, and then I am transferring the content of accumulator to a memory location which I call it as a T. And same way we are going to perform for the second term, that is I am going to copy the content of C into accumulator, then I am adding content of D to accumulator and storing the sum back to the accumulator, then multiply the content of T with the content of accumulator and store back the result into accumulator, and lastly store the content of accumulator into memory location X.
Similarly, I can also perform it using zero address instruction. In zero address instruction, we are going to make use of stack. So when I write the instruction push A, the content of A is pushed on top of the stack. When I say push B, the content of B will be put on the top of the stack. Before inserting B on top of the stack pointer is decremented so that it points to a new memory location. Then when we say add, it is going to perform addition of the two operands that are being pushed on top of the stack. Similarly, when we perform push C, push D, they will be pushed on top of the stack each time by decrementing the stack pointer. And when we say add, it will add the content of C with D. Then multiply operation, it is going to perform multiplication of C+D into A+B. Lastly, when I use the pop operation, the content of the value which is stored on top of the stack will now be stored to the memory location X. So we shall try to learn this in detail in the topic when we are dealing with stacks. So in the next class or in the next video, I will be explaining about branching. Till then, read the textbook and take care. Thank you for listening patiently.